ideals of Buddhism. Telangana and the youngest state of India. Cultural and historical center. It has part of present Telangana, known as Asaka Dhanapadas in the 6th century BC, mentioned in the Buddhist text Anguttara Nikaya.
Till a few years ago, the only way to reach Badanakurti, which is the present
మంగేష్ గారు మంగేష్ గారు మా బుద్ధవనం ప్రాజెక్టుకు ఎప్పటికప్పుడు తన అమూల్యమైన సలహాలు ఇస్తూ మమ్మల్ని ముందుకు నడిపిస్తున్నాడు. నాకు ఏ డౌట్ వచ్చినా కూడా మంగేష్ గారిని నేను అడుగుతుంటాను. నాకు విలువైన సలహాలు ఇస్తూ నన్ను వెన్నుదట్టి ముందడుగు నడిపిస్తున్నాడు. ఈ బుద్ధిజం ఈరోజు అతని లెక్చర్ వినడానికి నేను చాలా ఆసక్తితోని రావడం జరిగింది. ఐ వెల్కమ్ మంగేష్ జీ, ప్లీజ్ కమ్ టు ద డయాస్ అండ్ అడ్రస్ అవర్ పీపుల్. థ్యాంక్ యూ.
What I'm planning to do this morning, open up the house for about 20 minutes discussion, okay? So that we will go through what's... Ah, bhaiya, kahan pe gaye? PowerPoint, Shyam? And the title of the talk is going to be Shunyata in Pali text. So the idea of Shunyata and in relationship with what we can call the traditional a Buddhist text in terms of those written in the Pali, this is something which is foreign to the Pali text. And therefore, it's very important to look at this idea of Shunyata and Pali text in the context of the series that has begun here. And I think this is the fourth talk in that series of Nagarjuna lecture series. So let's begin with it. So the scheme of my presentation will be, Shyam, I will go through this, what is Shunyata, defining Shunyata, implications of Shunyata, Shunya in Pali text, and Shunyata in practice. Because most of the times we understand the concept as something to do with intellectualization, and we do not see that it can be useful to us in our lives in order to change ourselves. So this aspect of Shunyata in terms of practice is a very important aspect. So this is going to be the schemata of the presentation that I'm going to do this morning. Next. So let's get it very clear that Shunyata is not a concept or a view. It is not an idea. It is not something that pertains to what we can say the terms of thinking. It is not, it's a vision. And if we have to admit what it really is, it's a mode of perception as to how we look at the world. Next. So there are a lot of views around this concept of shunyata. Like some of these views are like, is shunyata nothing? Like if we say that it's nothing, it's empty, everything is empty, then it's very scary. Then what does the Buddha offer to you? If there is the view that everything is empty, everything is void, everything is zero, then what is it that the Buddha offers? It's a very scary view to think in those terms that, you know, nothing exists. Shunyata is also a style of thinking as to how we think through a lot of things that we witness, we experience, we understand in the world. As I said in the first slide, shunyata is also a mode of perception. It's an operational concept. If we qualify it as a concept, it has the dynamism attached to it. It entails freedom. Sometimes it entails ultimate reality. It is what is now termed as process philosophy, because all the philosophy, if we look at from the Greece to, you know, different sort of philosophies, they were all based on finding the prime substance. What is the world made up of ultimately? What is that prime substance? But now the analytical philosophy and the pragmatic philosophy has been talking about what we can say the process philosophy, that everything is process. If we try to find a substance, inherent reality in the world, we cannot find. Everything as if is arising dependent on something. So basically, it's a linchpin of process philosophy. It's very close to what we can call the doctrine of anatta, not self, dependent origination, a very technical term that, you know, I will explain you very briefly afterwards. Theory of knowledge as to how we understand the world, how we create the knowledge, how we understand it. Theory of logic, it offers us a kind of a theory of logic in order to validate whether something is true or false. It's also a source of creation of a new knowledge. And then it's a Buddhist dialectical tools. I'm very sorry, these are very heavy terms, but I'm going to go very quickly with it, you know, just to give you the glimpse of the topic. That my intention here is not to give you a kind of a confusing view about it, but just to give you the vastness, the complexities of the topic in hand. That shunyata is not an easy reality, easy topic to understand. Next. So for example, if an artist wants to talk about shunyata, how they will talk about shunyata? So there is a beautiful sort of an artistic impression about how we can define shunyata. There is a point in every art. Okay. So if you move that point, it becomes a line. If you move that line in a certain direction, you get a plane. If you move that plane, you get a cube. But when you look at that point, it's very indeterminate. You cannot define the point. Mathematically, it's very difficult to define what is a point. But if we do not assume the reality of the point, we cannot get a line, the set of infinite points. So that can be a very artistic understanding of shunyata. Next. The geometrical understanding of shunyata, as I said, you know, a point, if we move the point, it turns into light. If you move the line, it turns into plane. If you move the plane in cube, and then, you know, the other dimensions. Next. Now, in mathematics, this particular idea of shunyata is so powerful that it has changed the whole paradigm of science. There are whole range of discussion around what we can say, what is zero. And physics, mathematics, all revolve around this. And very interestingly, in the past it was said that the zero was discovered by an unknown Indian. But now we have very conclusive proof that the use of zero in terms of its mathematical usage was first found in the Buddhist monasteries. Very interesting. There is a manuscript which was discovered in Pakistan recently, which brought this fact out that zero was used in the monastery in order to keep the accounts, because the place of zero is very important. It is not just a number. Zero is not just a number. Its place is very important. Next. So when we move on further, just to disqualify some of the terms that we use for shunyata, it is not a noun. So it is not that there is something called shunya there. So it is definitely not a noun. Linguistically, it's very close to, adjective. It is not substance. As I said, it's not a view. It is not know nothing. It is not the prime element. Next. So for example, what happens? We all have different views depending on the filters that we have. If I am born in a particular community, particular nation, I am speaking particular language, my frame of reference changes according to my conditioning. And that gives rise to certain views. And those views, many a times those views create a conflict because the views are relative. And that's why when we talk about shunya, we have to talk on the two levels. On the level of the conventional reality and on the level of ultimate reality. So when we talk about shunyata on the basis of the frame of references that we have, sometimes we have very two different sort of extreme views. And the Buddha in his very first discourse has warned us against the views. He said in Pali, Nadve ante pabajjitena sevitabba. Those who have taken refuge, they cannot follow the two polarities because our mind is always moving between the polarities, extremities. So sometimes we are indulging into excessive sensual pleasure, thinking that, the pleasure of the senses is the ultimate reality. And sometimes we go through the self-mortification so much that we think that if we hurt ourselves, if we deny ourselves, we might be free. So these extreme polarities of the views, the right and left of it, basically according to the philosophy of shunya, this all sense of direction, all sense of ideologies are relative. So for example, if you say top and bottom, linguistically we say that top and bottom. But if you look at the earth, and if a person in the Mexico is talking about top and bottom, for them, what is bottom to us? You see what I'm saying? So this sense of directions, what we term, north, east, south, west, who has gone beyond the sensual pleasure, she means nothing. Or for a tiger in the forest, it's his meal. You see what I'm saying? So when we look at this relativity of understanding of what there is, actually we do not know what there is. And everything out there is mediated by our senses. We do not know what is there. A simple phenomenon of looking. It's explained scientifically that, these photons, they are bombarded on your retina, and the electrical signals are generated and inverted image is formed. And that is how we perceive that this is what is. The sounds that we hear, we do not know what is up there unless it is mediated by our ears. So whatever up there, out there, is always mediated by our senses. So that's why the Buddha cautions us, watch your senses. And understand at the sense doors, what is it that you are experiencing. Next. So what I thought, I would put some of the things about shunyata on the board up here. This is what the Buddha has to say about shunyata. Now all the complexities that I have created in the beginning will be simplified if you look at what the Buddha is saying here. What the Buddha is saying here is, when those discourses spoken by the Tathagata that are deep, deep in meaning, supra-mundane, dealing with emptiness, are being recited, we will be eager to listen to them. Because they are not easy matters to understand. We should be very eager. We should be very intent on listening to them. We lend an ear to them. We will be fully available to understand those teachings of the shunyata. We'll apply our minds to understand them. It's not simply listening about it. But we apply our minds to it as to understand what is it. And not only understand, we will think those teachings should be studied and mastered. And that is what you hold. That's what the Buddha says in Sayukta Nikaya. Next. Then there is this great Nagarjuna, on whose name this particular series is instituted. He is the philosopher of Shunyata. He has written a lot on Shunyata. Thousands and thousands of pages, palm leaves on Shunyata. But two of his works are very famous, like, you know, the particularly the second work, Madhyamik Karika. It's kind of an account of what is Shunyata. And there Nagarjuna goes so deep that his understanding comes very close to what now we get in form of theory of relativity. Some of the Europeans who have studied Nagarjuna's philosophy, they claim that, you know, he is an Indian Einstein. But we can say that, you know, Einstein was the Indian Nagarjuna. You see what I'm trying to get it at? Because the way he has gone into the depth of understanding the world. For example, you know, he says that nothing can be created. Everything evolves. For example, he says how he refutes the creator God. Because we all believe that the world was created by God. So how does Nagarjuna refute that? Very interesting. He says that when the world was created, it must be created out of something. Right? If something is created, for example, if this paper is created, this paper has to be created out of something. If you say that the paper was created out of nothing, then we cannot talk. But we assume that the world was created of something, then before the creator God created earth, there must be something. Now that something, before that something came, there must be something. So if you follow this logic, we come to what is called reductio ad absurdum. We find that the whole logical theory fails, and we cannot find that there is a creation. There is a continuous evolution, that one thing is leading to another. And that's a very fundamental Buddhist doctrine that pertains to Shunyata. Okay? One thing leading to another thing leading to another, like that, conditioning. Conditioned co-production, that is what is the technical term in Buddhism for what I'm trying to describe. Nothing can be created of its own. Depending on the conditions, the things arise. Depending on the conditions, the things fall away. That's very simple as that. Next. So what Nagarjuna says, when emptiness is possible, everything is possible. We exist because there is no inherent reality. If there was something independent, there was something permanent, we cannot simply come into being. Imagine that we remain who we are. Then what happens? No, nothing is possible. I cannot talk. If there is something concrete, you know, there is something permanent, how can I talk? Because in order to generate my speech, everything has to move. So, because, you know, when emptiness is possible, everything is possible. Where emptiness is impossible, nothing would be possible. That's what Nagarjuna says. Next. And very interestingly, what Nagarjuna says, that we are always trying to argue about views, saying that my view is better than your view. My ideology is better than your ideology. And therefore, we see that there is so much conflict in the world. Because we believe in the permanency of the views. While what Nagarjuna says here, that if I had stated any thesis, I would be at fault. But since I have not stated any thesis, I am not at fault. That means Nagarjuna has no thesis to prove. He has nothing to argue. The Buddha has nothing to argue. Now you will say that, you know, Buddha has given so many discourses. And, you know, he has, you know, if you compile the Pali literature, it will be in the big three baskets. If you combine this Chinese Buddhist resources, it's a huge sort of, you know, it can pile up to somebody. Some people say the 80 story of building. That's what they say. So much of Buddhist literature. But, you know, I'm trying to say here that the Buddha has nothing to argue. Why? Because Buddha dwells in emptiness. Nagarjuna, when he claims that, he dwells in emptiness. And we will come to that. Next. Very interestingly, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar has referred to this concept in the Buddha and his Dhamma. The monumental book that he wrote, he says that shunyata doesn't mean nihilism out and out, because we think that everything is going to get destroyed. That's one view. It only means the perpetual changes occurring at every moment in the phenomenal world. So when we talk about shunyavad, we have to talk about shanikvad, impermanence. There is nothing permanent in the world. Everything changes moment to moment. Very few realize that it is on account of shunyata that everything becomes impossible. That's what Dr. Ambedkar says. Without it, nothing in the world would be possible. It is on the impermanence of the nature of all things that the possibility of all other things depend. If in the existence there is something permanent, then the world cannot simply be what it is. So impermanence and shunyata are the basic attributes, the basic qualities of everything. Next. Okay. If things were not subject to continual change, but were permanent and unchangeable, the evolution of all life from one kind to the other and the development of living things would come to a dead stop. Going further, he says, if human beings had not died or changed, but had continued always in the same state, what would be the result have been? The progress of the human race would have come to a dead halt. Next. Immense difficulty would have arisen if shunyata is regarded as being void or empty. But this is not so. Shunya is like a point which has a substance, as we have seen, substance not in terms of a substance, material, but neither breadth or length. All things are impermanent was the doctrine preached by the Buddha. What is the moral of this doctrine of the Buddha? This is much more important question. The moral of this doctrine of impermanence is simple. Do not be attached to anything. This is Dr. Ambedkar on shunyata. So I think this is very important, that all the time we are grabbing onto something. We are latching onto something. We are latching onto our bodies. We are latching onto our views. We are trying to attach ourselves to our bodies, thinking that our bodies are going to remain the same. They are not going to change. Thinking that our views are going to remain the same. They are not going to change. Thinking that whatever the state of mind I have, whatever emotions I have, they will be there. They are not going to change. But here we gets a very entirely different perspective on what it means to be empty. So emptiness is not a psychological state that you say, I feel empty. It is the inherent reality, a quality of everything, that if we deconstruct, we do not find anything permanent. Nothing permanent. We do not find anything permanent. Next. So therefore, this very concept has implication in terms of the theory and practice of liberation, theory of knowledge, as I said, epistemology, theory of logic, theory of relativity, Buddhist dialectics. Next. Now, shunyata, as I said, is always, most of the times, associated with a great philosopher who was born, who was preached here, just nearby here. And he has written extensively, and there is a lot of discussion going on, a lot of philosophizing going on around what he taught. But if we look at the Pali text very closely, we can see that the shunya is present. Now we have to understand these two words, shunya and shunyata. So shunyata is a state. But shunya is something else. So in the Pali literature, most of the times that the word that you get is shunya. Because shunyata is a state. And as I said, that the shunyata is not state, it's not substance. So let's look at this. Sutras or suttas in Pali that pertains to shunyata. There is Mahashunyata Sutta, there is Chula Shunyata Sutta, there is Shunya Sutta, there is a Kanchana Gota Sutta, and references to shunyata are scattered throughout the Pali text. They are scattered throughout the Pali text. So for example, this particular text that I am referring to here, Kanchana Gota Sutta, has been referred by Nagarjuna. So all Nagarjuna's philosophy is derived from this Pali text. He has elaborated intellectually, he has elaborated conceptually, he has elaborated analytically, but the source of his doctrine or his philosophy lies in this very important sutta called the Kanchana Gotta Sutta. Next. So basically, when we look at Shunyata in practice based on Pali text, it teaches us about the emptiness of self. That how hard you try to find in your existence, your Atma, you cannot find. And we will come to that. So the whole reality is conditioned. How hard we try to find that there is something in my existence which never changes. So Buddha challenges us to find out in our body and mind anything which never changes, which remains as it is. Then emptiness of substantiality. So we'll go further. Next. So for example, you know, if you want to see that, you know, your existence is devoid of the self, there is this matrix given by the Buddha in order to understand that there is no self, not self. Instead of no self, we can say not self. There is nothing that belongs to me. So for example, if you look at body, if it is not empty, what will happen? It should continue forever. Does it continue forever like that? We were born as a, you know, then we grew up, we became old, then eventually we die. Our bodies have changed completely. We don't realize it. But if we look at the body, it is undergoing continuous change. For no single moment of time, our body is static. It's dynamic. Whether our body is independent? No. We are all the time dependent on something. For example, if we don't breathe, even for 2-3 seconds, if our brain doesn't get the blood, what happens? If we don't eat food, what happens? So our existence depends, our body cannot exist of its own. It is dependent. Then control. We do not have any control of on our body. Do we have any control on our hair? That if we, you know, if our hair are falling, can we say that stop, you don't fall? Can we control? Can we control our health in terms of, you know, it should not get, we should never get sick? We cannot. And singleness, can we point out to something, some body as a singular thing? No, because the body is constituted by so many organs, so many elements. Same that you apply to what pertains to the body, the answer will be negative when you evaluate it on the basis of continuity, independence, control and singleness. The same with our mind. The same goes on for our mind. And what pertains to mind, like emotion, thoughts, thinking, so on and so forth. None of our thinking is continuous. None of our thinking is independent. Most of our thinking is borrowed by others, borrowed from others. Isn't it? We cannot control our mind. We cannot, you know, if my mind is sad now, I cannot say in one snap of finger, now be happy. You see what I'm getting at? And singleness, there is no single event that we can find in the mind. Same with if you argue that we take body and mind as something, you know, one reality, even that doesn't apply to the body mind, continuity, independence, control and singleness. So when we analyze our body and mind with this matrix, what we find that we cannot hold on to anything as me, as I, as mine. And in the Pali text, the Buddha has come up with a very beautiful formula. Na etang mama, this is not me. Na aham eso asmi. Na etang attati, this is not myself. So when you analyze your body, when you analyze your mind with this frame, what happens? You become free. Because your mind doesn't dwell at one, it's not arrested by anything, any view, any emotion, it's not arrested. You're free to be. You're free to be what you are. And I think that's very important teaching of the Buddha. So what we get here, if we apply this matrix in our own existence, we find that inherently there is no self. It's empty of self. Instead of saying that there is no self, we can say that our body is empty of self. Okay? Same applies with the material world. Like, you know, the science has told us that, you know, when you go and, you know, disintegrate everything, what do you find? You ultimately get down to the electronic level. When you go further than atomic level, electronic, when you go further than that, what happens? You can never find a particle. You can never find a particle. And you are not even sure, you are uncertain whether that's a particle or a wave. That's what the physics is getting at now. We are not sure. It depends on our perception whether that's particle or a wave. So the human perception has a definite role to play in shaping up the reality for the human beings. You see what I'm getting at? So whether that's a particle or a wave depends on the way you want to perceive it. That is the power of, you know, creation of, you know, quote unquote reality of the human mind. It's a very powerful device. It creates the world. It creates a static world for us because we need it in order to survive. But what we need for our survival ultimately affects us very badly. So this is a very important matrix that the Buddha has given. And then he came to the conclusion that in your existence, if you evaluate all your experiences based on these three, four characteristics, you cannot find, you find that you are devoid of self. Whatever you are cherishing as me, as I, as mine, is all construct. It's a sociological construct. It's a language, it's a linguistic construct. The language construct the whole reality. Because I cannot say that this person is talking. So I have to say, I am talking with you. But if you analyze the simple sentence like this, I am talking to you. Now, who is talking to who? You go down and think what's happening. So what do we say? The process of talking is happening. In the Bahya Sutta, the Buddha says that there is no seer. Only the process of seeing is taking place. Seeing is a process. You see what I'm trying to say? Nobody there inside us who is sitting and looking at the world. Only the process of seeing is happening. Only the process of listening is happening. There is nobody who is listening to it. Next. So when we look at, analyze our experiences from this standpoint, we see that I, me, my, mine, they are just conventions. Linguistic conditioning. Buddha said, watch your language. Because the language tries to solidify your experiences. We sometimes say linguistically, okay, this person is bad. But you know, the reality of every person is that their self changes all the time, dynamic self. So what do you think of them now, they might not be the same in the future. You see what I'm saying? You know, today some people are your friends, tomorrow they can be your enemies. Today they are your enemies, tomorrow they can be your friends. So, linguistic conditioning, this I, and the Buddha goes on explaining as to how this construct of I comes into being, how the construct of me comes into being, how the construct of my comes into existence. He says that the Thanapo means the child who is on his or her mother's milk, they have no identity. Then how the identity comes? Through the cultural conditioning, in the family we are born. Isn't it? Can a child know that what caste, what religion, what nation they are born into? It's very interesting. And Buddha goes into that. This identity consciousness, how it arises. The sense of I am this, I am that. This is also a linguistic device. When I say I am that, it's a linguistic device. There is no inherent reality in there. So we have to watch for the linguistic conditioning. Then there is a social conditioning. There's a lot of conditioning that goes on in our mind because of the culture. And then identities. We stick to our identities. We identify ourselves that I am an Indian. Or I am speaking this language. You know, I am black, I am white, I am male, I am female. So these identities are deconstructed with the shunyata. So in other words, anatta is shunyata. Next. So as I was referring to you that Nagarjuna has derived his teaching from the sutta that we see, Kanchana Gotta Sutta. So where the Buddha says that there are two views, athi nathi, means there is and there is not. So sometimes we say that nothing exists and sometimes we say that everything exists. So Buddha says, these are just the views. we cannot say that, you know, something exists or something doesn't exist, because it's all our perceptions. So there are two important aspects from the Buddhist point of view: absence of self and absence of substance. Next, the basic important thing about why Shunya is called the middle path is because it asks you to avoid the extremities. The Buddha says that you should not fall in the polarities of the things. You should not firm up your opinion about something. You shouldn't hold anything, even ideology, any concept, tightly, because they are dynamic. They are operational concept. They are means to something. They are not end in themselves. So, what there is, if you ask me the question, what there is, the most important point that comes now, when we understand it, is very much, very nicely summarized by what the Buddha talked when he talked about the Paticchasamutpada. Dependent origination, that nothing can stand of its own. Everything arises depending on the condition. So for example, the Buddha gives it in a very simple formula. He says that this is, that is. This is not, that is not. With the arising of this, that arises. With the cessation of this, that ceases. Now this is the process that happens all the time. So why, you know, if you ask how we are born, so depending on certain conditions we are born. And those conditions are absent, we die. If you apply this formula, this is a general formula, and it can be applied in the specific conditions also, as to how something arises and how something falls away. Depending on what condition something arises, depending on what condition something ceases. John Dewey, the great philosopher, he said that the person who has understood this law was the first scientist and technologist in the world. Because this is the core of science. Unless you understand how things arise depending on what conditions, you cannot create something. So this is the heart of not only Buddhism, but also science. And this is possible because inherently everything is empty of anything permanent. If there was even this tinge of permanence in the world, nothing would have been possible. The Buddha says, you know, taking some soil in his pinch of hand, saying that in the world you cannot find even this much permanent. Everything, if it exists, has to be impermanent. And that is what is very much captured in this beautiful formula given by the Buddha, the general law of conditioning. This is, that is. This is not, that is not. With the arising of this, that arises. With the cessation of this, that ceases. You can apply it in sociology, you can apply it in politics, you can see how the identities comes into being, on what conditions they come into being. If those conditions are absent, those identity fall apart. That's why the role of conditioning must be understood. As I said, that the Buddha said that the Thanapo, the child, the 3 years old child, has no identity consciousness. So where does this identity consciousness come from? It's a conditioning. Next. Now, we were talking about the background, the definitions, the sort of place of Shunyata in the Pali text. Now, what Buddha has done very meticulously in the Pali text, he has turned this whole theory into practice, as to how we can empty our mind all the time. So for example, we are carrying a lot of burdens, the burden of views, the burden of destructive emotions, so many things we carry. Even if we are sitting in this room, our mind might be in the city, might be in the home. We might be carrying our home here. Isn't it? We might be carrying the whole gamut of experiences out there in this room. While what Buddha says, you empty whatever out there, you be here. This is the moment. You cannot bring your home, your relations in this room, because the reality of what is happening, unfolding in this room, is empty of what is happening outside. Very meticulously the Buddha goes on defining. He says that when you enter in the forest, what happens? The forest is empty of the city life. So the forest is empty of the chariots, the forest is empty of the hustle bustle of the city life, the forest is empty of the people in the city. So he says that you empty your mind of that perceptions when you enter into the forest. And you establish yourself in the singular perception of that forest. So for example, if we have to apply shunyata in this room, we have to empty ourselves from what's going on outside, because that is not there is. What is it is it's here. This is the reality of the moment which is happening now, which is unfolding at this very moment here and now. So when the meditation progresses like that, based on the shunyata, that we empty whatever are disturbing our mind. Then we empty our mind of, you know, what is going on outside. Then our mind is more focused. Then the new mental state arises. You empty yourself of this mental state. And ultimately your mind is completely free, unburdened, very supple, very flexible to do what it can do. But if your mind is crunched up with so many ideologies, so many viewpoints, you cannot respond to the situation. And from there comes what we can term in Buddhism the compassion. Because emptiness, devoid of self, that doesn't mean that, you know, there is no emotion. The state of the absence of self doesn't mean that you become dry. You become alive and full of life. You become full of life in order to respond to what is in the hand, what is before you, what is immediately needed. Next. So I will leave this particular talk with this image to you. And you know, this will have a sort of a concrete example of what I have been talking for last 30-40 minutes. You know, in the Buddhist scriptures, there is a very important Pali text called the Questions of Milinda, Milinda Panno. And the Milinda Panno begins with a discussion between Milinda and Nagasen. Now, Nagasen is man of nothing. While if you look at Milinda, he is a man of everything. He is a king, knowledge, he has read widely, he has argued with a lot of different people. He has engaged himself with all different ideologies. And he is having a debate with Nagasena. So the first thing that happens between them is this very important discussion which pertains to emptiness. So what is that discussion between them? So he says, what is your name? He says, my name is Milinda, Nagasena. So he says, oh, who is Nagasena? Can you show me where is Nagasena? He says, no. So he asks, is your head Nagasena? Is your body Nagasena? Whatever. So he says, I'm asking you who is Nagasena, and you are not answering. You are such a highly renowned monk and you are telling me lies. So then he says, he gives the simile of the chariot. He says, when you talk about the chariot, is chariot the yoke? No. Is chariot a wheel? No. Is axle the chariot? No. Is the flagstaff chariot? No. When you deconstruct like that, you don't find rath. You don't find a chariot. You deconstruct anything like that, you say radio. You say this microphone. But if you take the parts away, where is the microphone? If you deconstruct me, you know, if somebody, some butcher is selling a cow. So when the cow is cut into pieces, sorry, it's a very, this example, he doesn't say, come and buy cow. What he says? Buy this gurda, buy this, this, whatever. Like that, when you deconstruct something, you cannot find that entity up there. So he says, I'm not telling you the lies. It is for the conventional sense that I am called Nagasena. In ultimate sense, Nagasena doesn't exist. Thank you. So what do? We can, open up
thing and live our life as if the body is permanent. It's never going to die. So the concept of shunyata gives you a vantage point by which we can analyze our own identities. And we can find that in our perceptions, we cannot hold on to anything as our identity. So then what is our identity? Our identity is the construct. It's a social construct, it's a cultural construct, and more than that, it's a linguistic construct. So when I say I, it doesn't refer to anything in my body. It is just a conventional sound that I use for the phenomena that is standing before you. So that's shunyata.
What about the Buddhism in Telangana state?
Buddhism in Telangana has a long history. It is one of the very important states, region in the world, that has given a kind of a very different sort of a philosophy to the world that has its effect on Japan, Korea, Tibet, China. The philosophy that is known as Mahayana, which is based on a very pragmatic, practical teachings of, for example, Shunyavad, for example, the teaching of how everything is empty of the permanent things. These teachings originated in Telangana, in a region which was known as the Sri Parvata Agama. So it's near Nagarjuna Sagar, Konda. Nagarjuna Sagar. And the most important thing about Telangana, that you go anywhere, any district in Telangana, you will find that there are Buddhist remains. So you go Fanigiri or you go Dhullikat. You go anywhere in Telangana, you will find that there is a rich tradition of Buddhism in this region. And I think what we need to do now is to really preserve the Buddhist heritage of Telangana, which has contributed to so much of culture in the world.
What type of programs will take to develop the Buddhism in our state?
First of all, it's very, very, very important to understand what is Buddhism. It's very important because the Buddha's teaching is based on Maitri, Metta. It's based on compassion. It's love, respect, and reverence for a fellow human being. Without that love, respect, and reverence for a fellow human being, a harmonious society is impossible. So whenever there is a conflict, the Buddha comes into, play, and he teaches us, he gives us the tools to understand that the whole identities are the creations. We cannot treat other human beings lesser or higher than us. We can just treat other human beings the way we will treat ourselves. So I think what we need to do in Telangana is to really understand what are the core teachings of the Buddha. And not only understand, but apply them in our individual lives, in our social lives, in our national life.
Good name, sir?
My name is Mangesh Dahiwale.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
People everywhere, anywhere.
For the development of the new Buddhist thinking. So if you take the combined United States of Andhra Pradesh, you can see that it's, you know, the imprints, the footprints of the Buddhism everywhere. So for example, in Telangana, if you go. Now coming to the modern times, I think we have to act very cautiously, not to make Buddhism into a commodity. In order to is that we try to use Buddhism as a commodity to attract money or, you know, to attract investments, so on and so forth. So the future of Buddhism in Andhra Pradesh depends on how seriously we take the philosophy of Buddha and make it into a way of life. For example, the Buddha and the Buddhist philosophy is all about, as we just saw in the talk, not holding these views are ultimately empty. So if we imbue the Buddhist philosophy of, for example, the teaching of metta, the Buddha put yourself in the shoes of others. Just like that, the philosophy of non-discrimination, the philosophy of respect, reverence for all that is life around us. So I think the future is definitely there. What we all need to do is to strive very hard in order to really practice Buddhism in terms of the way of life and not make it into a commodity. So there is a bright future, sir. See, any idea needs the propagation, and it's impossible if the people don't practice it. So it depends on you and me, sir, as to how much we practice it, isn't it? So the responsibility, see, life inspires life. The ideas can inspire for some time, but if you see the embodiment of those ideas in somebody, you inspire them. So it's happened, it will happen, sir. In terms of the historically, it was neither Telangana nor Andhra. Isn't it? These are new identities which have now come up. Some of them are political identities, some of them are ethnic identities. So I think I will not fall in the trap of Telangana, Andhra. No, ultimately the identities are operational. In themselves, they don't mean anything if they don't help us, you know, to be. If some identities which are locking you inside, not letting you be free as a human being, those ideas, as we have seen in the lectures, are ultimately not helpful. So I won't divide like this, Telangana, Andhra. Sir,
Sir, I won't answer that because I think that's a very political question.
Thank you, Dr. Mahesh. You have given a nice lecture. I am Mr. K.V. Rao, retired from Archaeological Survey of India. I worked in Nagarjunakonda Museum for 8 years at the head of the museum. Before that, I was in Amaravati Museum for 2 years. Though I worked in Buddhist places, I didn't go inside the Nagarjuna's philosophy. You have enlightened us. Thank you. I'm sure your name was Saish. You are either from Goa or Maharashtra. Maharashtra. Oh, thank you. Thank you. You have given a nice lecture. Dr. Mangesh, thank you.
Bhai, actually, talking philosophy is very tough because you don't have any physical evidences. You'll be talking about the things which are operating in mind, and you made us to think. That is first and foremost success of this lecture. Second thing is, I want something more about the continuity of Buddhist philosophy from Buddha to Nagarjuna, Nagarjuna to post-Nagarjuna, how that has influenced this Shunyata, concept of Shunyata. Buddha's Pratitya Samutpada has come into Shunyata because Nagarjuna himself says in Kartika, without understanding Shunyata, you can't understand Pratitya Samutpada. Then comes to the next stage, post-Nagarjuna, how this concept of Shunyata has been appropriated by the Indian philosophers or Indian texts. Because someone was asking about the future of Buddhism in Telangana or in India. How things have been changed in terms of philosophy, how Nagarjuna's Shunyata concept has transformed, whether it is in Gaudapada or Shankara, Kumarila Bhattu and all those concepts. Thank you.
We have to look at the kind of the dialectical tension that has taken place during the course of Indian history. And basically, when you see the argumentation and the counter arguments, we see that there is this sort of a Brahminical viewpoint which is sort of being pushed and sometimes clad in the Buddhist terminology and given to the people that this is what is it. But ultimately, if you look at it, like for example, the people like Shankara has said that the Buddhist philosophy is nothing but belonging to Vedas or something like that, and Buddha was a daemon who gave the milk in the leather sort of a bag. So if you see this kind of what I would say the antagonism towards Buddhism, I think it's more on the political ground than the philosophical ground, because on the philosophical ground, Brahminism could never defeat Buddhists. If you look at the whole journey of the philosophy in this country, for example, if you see the argument of Dignag post Nagarjuna and that of Dharmakirti, you see that they are clearly trying to prove something which pertains to the human being and the reality, while all the logical system of the Kumarila Bhatt, Gaudapada and like that, you talk about this big Naya school logic and you end up proving that they are the words from the Veda, Veda Praman. Okay, but the Buddhist said Pratyaksha Praman. Okay, while the Brahmins were always trying to get back whether these are the words from the Vedas. If they are not the words from the Vedas, they are not true. So for example, how Kumarila Bhattra defends Manu, saying that his words are traced in the Vedas. That's why Manu is true. While Dignaga and Dhammakirti says that's not true. The Buddha's words are true because they come from his compassion. Because he has nothing political in it. Because he has nothing to prove. He has nothing to dominate. So I think what you pointed out is very interesting, sir. And this sort of tension, between this Buddhist and Brahminical sort of the ideologies or viewpoints or the worldview clashed all the time. But I think it was not the philosophical defeat that Buddhism has gone into. It's more of a political, sir. It's more of an onslaught on the Buddhist institutes, the Buddhist themselves. So, to answer that question, we have to go into depth of it. But I think that is what it is. The Brahminical system, philosophical system could never defeat Buddhism. Philosophical completely appropriate, sir. Yeah. For example, as I said, that the Shunya is not a substance. It's an operational concept. It's a process. It's not a substance philosophy. It's a process philosophy. Now, what you do, you add substance into saying that
the reality is having. To give you an example, you know, there is in the Nyaya school, you always talk about Veda Praman, validity of the Vedas. But the Buddhists never talk about it. Buddhists talk about the Pratyaksha Praman, what is there. And then the Praman based on the evidences. How you prove it logically that something is true. And the whole logical system of Buddhism, when you study, you find that it was developed to completely. And you can find, if you trace his footprints, you can find that he was definitely influenced by Buddha. When he was studying in the Columbia University, he read the Pali text society literature fully. In 1916, there is a book by Rich Davis where his signature is there, Dr. Ambedkar's signature is there, 1916. I am talking about 16 when he was in the Columbia University, still a student. Because before that, his life was deeply impacted by Dada Saheb Kelusker, who wrote an important book on Buddha, the biography of the Buddha in Marathi. And Dr. Ambedkar said in his conversion speech that the Buddhist impact on him is that old. Then you trace his speeches, like, you know, the famous speech like Annihilation of Caste, for example. In the very front piece of the Annihilation of Caste, he quotes Buddha saying that, know the truth as truth and untruth as untruth. If you take the next speech next year in Dadar, what way freedom? He says that the freedom, you can have freedom only when you follow the Buddha. Be your own light, in 1936, he says. In 1936, he is telling his people, be your own light. In 1940s, he starts celebrating the Buddha Jayanti. 41, he writes a beautiful article on the political significance of Buddha Jayanti. So I think deeply impacted, not studied by the scholars much, but if you see, look at his life, his house is named after the place where the Buddha lived, Rajagriha. He names his colleges after Milind College and then Anandvan and the Buddha Hall, Siddharth College. So his love for the Buddha is immense. His love for the Buddha is very immense, sir. So he was deeply, 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 deeply influenced by the Buddha. There are many stories which I can tell you now, but I think, you know, I won't have that time, but deeply. You cannot separate the Buddhist thoughts from the movement of Dr. Ambedkar. It's not that something happened in 1956 that we have to take it from there and say that, you know, he converted in 1956. If you read his books, if you read his speeches, if you look at his life, in 1936, a monk from Italy went to see him, Lokanath, 1936. And he wrote a letter to Ambedkar after that. And he said, I know that you will be only Buddhist. You cannot be otherwise. I still remember the solitary picture of the Buddha in your room. In 1936, there was only one picture, the picture Dr. Ambedkar had in his room. And that was the picture of Buddha. Particularly, I have a problem with this word Harijan, but, you know, just an identity if you are trying to put it. But see, you cannot remain in the hell of caste. The religion that makes you feel that you are lower than the cats and dogs, that cannot be your religion. Okay. So the number one thing, you have to come out of that container. You cannot remain in that container and fight, because that system will always push you down. So ultimately, you have to leave that and embrace something which is more egalitarian, which is based on liberty, equality and fairness. You are all welcome, and you please spread the word that, you know, such kind of an event is taking place in this hall. Thank you so much.